My topic would be vertebral injury in cervical spine surgery. This is a very difficult topic to overview because vertebral injury respect is quite different from between each different type of surgery. For example, anterior surgery, posterior surgery, and each different type of posture. But it could be higher in terms of vertebral injury. And other methods can be lower than any type of construct. So I discuss about vertebral injury and review the normal anatomy and anatomical variations and each different surgical strategy depending on anatomical variations in terms of C1 screw, C2 screw. And also, I hope I can discuss about the low cervical spine vertebral injury if time is available. And I'll give you some cases of mine. I was doing C1-2 fixation because our patient has a C1-2 instability. I made a hole around the center of the C2 pedicle because I thought pedicle was very wide enough. But there was a severe bleeding because of a vertebral injury during the surgery. So is there anybody who experienced vertebral injury? Not that much. And other people is quite lucky enough to save your life. Because whenever you experience a vertebral injury during surgery, it's quite heartbreaking. So you can expect your life expectancy can be decreased at the same. Patient was quite lucky enough because they don't have, she didn't experience any neurological complication after the surgery. But as you can see here, the trajectory of the C2 pedicle screw is quite low than I expected. So this is a possible surgical error during the surgery. There's lots of literature in articles about vertebral injury, but the incidence is quite low. The incidence of vertebral injury is less than 1% in anterior surgery. And in terms of posterior surgery, transarticular screw fixation is higher than the lateral screw fixation. And also pedicle screw fixation is higher than a lateral screw fixation. Even though it's very rare, it could be potentially devastating because it can cause a severe bleeding and cause a hypovolemic shock during the surgery. And also it can cause ischemia, such as Wallenberg syndrome, as you know. These factors of vertebral injury is average course of vertebral, and also if you choose an inadequate instrumentation technique, it can cause a vertebral injury. And also, if you disoriented during the surgery because of a tumor or infection and any kind of a lesion, and inexperiences and distorted landmark can cause a vertebral injury during surgery. So as you know, there's a full part of the vertebral in terms of location of the vertebral. But usually C2-3, V2-3 segment is a region of interest because a lot of cervical spine surgery, we do those level of vertebral. Nowadays, C1-2 segment of fixation is becoming popular because it has an advantage over transarticular screw fixation, such as diet manipulation possible. You can use this type of construct in the cases of obese patient and thoracic hypoplasia patient. And less risk of vertebral would be expected because entry point is higher and project angle is less steep. But still, this type of surgery is quite challenging until now because there's a critical neurovascular structure around there. For example, spinal cord, C2 nerve root, hypoglossal nerve, and vertebral, and also ISA and sinus. Usually, technical problem can cause vertebral injury around the craniovertebral junction, and also anatomical variations such as V3 segment anomaly, posterior ponticles, bony abnormality, and also high-riding vertebral could be a risk factor of the vertebral injury. If you choose inadequate entry point of the screw during your C1 screw placement, it can cause vertebral injury like this. And also, even though you choose the adequate entry point of Cyanotomy school, but you have to keep in mind in most cases of the Cyanotomy instability, it's very easy to be rotated during manipulation, for example, making entry point, tapping, and screw insertion, you can cause a Cyan rotated ipsilateral artery. So in those situations, you can cause a rotator injury. You usually choose infrared as an entry point because you usually made an arch below the Cyan arch to make a space between Cyan arch and sitting of root, and then dissect the sitting of root in the insert direction. And usually make an entry point between the junction between arch and lateral mass in such a screw. This because water arch is usually located over the Cyan arch. But some cases, patient has a V3 segment on the body. First type of anomaly is persistent intersegment artery, which is water artery course abnormal below the Cyan arch. And second type is fenestration. And duplicated vertebral artery course above and below the Cyan arch. And also, small branch of early branch of pica originate below the Cyan arch. In those situations, inferior lateral mass is not a good entry point for Cyan replacements. So we have to change our strategy to place Cyan in those situations. The instance of V3 segment anomaly around 5% in my country. And if there's a V3 segment anomaly, only architecture can be changed. As you can see here, if there's a asymmetrically small transverse foramen in C1, there could be a vertebral anomaly. And in the situation of if there's a right side transverse vertebral artery, there could be a deep groove in the ipsilateral side of Cyan. So Cyan inner architecture could be distorted. And if there's a persistent type intersegment artery in the left side, there's a deep groove on the left side ipsilateral Cyan canal. So even though CT angiography is not available, you can detect those type of bony architecture change, you can predict those type of V3 segment anomaly. I show some cases. Here's a typical case of rheumatoid arthritis related central instability. There's an ADID increase on flexion image. But the interesting thing is, there, if you see the right side CT angiography, there's an early branch of pica. So in this situation, you cannot place the Cyan screw below the Cyan arch because you can damage the vertebral artery in pica branch and cause a Wallenberg syndrome after the screw instrumentation. So I choose those arches as an entry point. I dissected above the Cyan arch and below the Cyan arch to dissect the vertebral artery itself and the only pica branch and make an entry point in the Cyan arch and insert the screw. But if you choose Cyan dose arch as an entry point, we have to evaluate the thickness of the Cyan arch because some cases Cyan arch thickness is not good enough for the 3.5 or 4 millimeter screw. So in the situation there's a thickness is not good enough, you have to change your strategy. And also, if there's a posterior point tooth, if you misunderstand this type of OVM abnormality as a thick lamina or wide lamina to place the Cyan screw, you can damage the vertebral artery below the Cyan arch. So whenever you choose a Cyan arch as an entry point, you have to evaluate the thickness and any type of bony abnormality. Second case is a left side persistent type intersegment artery. As you can see here, left side vertebral artery cools abnormally below the Cyan arch. So in this kind of situation, you cannot place the Cyan screw below the Cyan arch. So I choose the entry point over the Cyan arch. Good thing is there's not so much venous plexus. As you know, there's a lot of profuse bleeding over the Cyan arch, but if you choose the entry point over the Cyan arch, there's no venous plexus. You can make entry point, tapping and screw insertion like this. And there's a big difference between right side and left side in terms of the height of the screw placement. And third case is a combined bony abnormality. There's a occipital stimulation, clitoral fail, and Sion bifida. In those situations, there's a right side polyrachial pica, and left side there's a tortuous vertebrae cruise abnormally below the CNR. So in this situation, we have to change your steroid to place the CNR screw placement. Angiography shows on right side, there's an olibranchial pica, and left side, persistent type of vertebrae cruise below the CNR. So I choose transarticular type of screw for left side, and those are just an entry point for right side. Final construct is like this. And first case is similar, congenital anomaly, occipital stimulation and clitoral fail. There's a CNR instability. And bilateral persistent type of intersegmental arch is located below the CNR. So I skip the level of CNR fixation and extend the level of fixation up to the cranium. So there's a five different techniques in the cases of V3 segmental anomaly. First one, you can choose those arches as an entry point, and spiralism as an entry point, and you can choose transarticular type of screw for center screw fixation. And also, we can skip the level of fixation, and also we can mobilize the vertebrae, but it could be critical because we cannot guarantee the vertebrae injury or embolism during manipulation. There's a lot of literature about the V3 segmental anomaly, mostly coming from Asian populations. Usually around 5% or up to 13%. But interesting thing is very small articles about the V3 segmental anomaly published in the Caucasian population. The incidence is quite low. So I'd like to analyze the real instance in the clinical practice who need CNR screw fixation in my institute. Total number was around 150. I want to evaluate which one is the risk factor of the V3 segmental anomaly. The instance was 7.5%, and there are mostly persistent type of intersegmental artery. There are two cases of olibranchial pica. There's no cases of penetration, and there's one case of combination, persistent intersegmental artery and olibranchial pica. Interesting thing was the instance is quite different from normal architecture and cases with congenital bony abnormalities such as osteodontoidium, clitoral fail, occipital stimulation, and spina bifida. So congenital bony abnormality could be a risk factor of the V3 segmental anomaly. So in the cases of if there's a bony abnormality around the cranio-vertebral junction, you have to keep in mind there could be a V3 segmental anomaly. So we have to evaluate any kind of imaging study such as CT angiography in any CT scan, or if it is not available, you have to check the CT scan to detect any type of bony architecture distortion. In terms of situ screw, there could be a four type of construct: transarticular screw, par screw, pedicle screw, and laminar screw. This is a typical type of situ pedicle screw. I usually make an entry point in the superior medial quadrant of the situ pedicle and identify the medial margin of the pedicle and follow the medial margin as a trajectory of the situ pedicle screw. But in the cases of high riding vertebrae, which is a vertebrae course abnormally higher and medial inside the situ pedicle, we cannot place a situ pedicle screw or CNR transarticular screw type of construct. The instance of unilateral high-riding vertebrae is around 20% and bilateral 4%. Situation, pedicle screw and transarticular screw cannot be for situ screw fixations. In normal architecture, you can place CN2 transarticular screw or pedicle screw very safely, but in the situation of high-riding vertebrae, transarticular screw or pedicle screw can damage the vertebral artery like this. And in the cases of joint mutilation in CNR facet joint, for example, rheumatoid arthritis cases, there could be a higher than what of the instance could be higher than the normal populations. Here's a case of a vertebral injury during the school, sit-to-sit school placement. After 20 days later, patient complaining weakness. So I evaluated the MRI. There could be a, there is a brain ischemia bump. Delayed ischemia can happen if you place the, if you damage the vertebral artery like this. So in this situation, only two viable options is a laminar screw and pulse screw. So laminar screw could be a best option because it can reduce the risk of vertebral artery injury, and also you don't need to fluoroscope because you can palpate the inner cortex of the C2 lamina during the surgery. You can guarantee the damage of any kind of spinal cord or vertebral artery. The video clip for pulse screw. Pulse screw entry point quite higher and medial to the compared to the pedicle screw. So I always dissect the medial margin of the pedicle and detect where is the safe zone. And this is a video for laminar screw. The entry point of the laminar screw is junction between spinous process and lamina, and follow the contralateral lamina for trajectory of the screw. And you can combine the laminar screw and pulse screw in the bilateral higher than vertebral artery cases. You can place pulse screw, laminar screw, and hybrid technique. Most important thing is the morphometric study is important to decide the thickness of the lamina or depth of the pulse. That is very important one for the preoperative evaluations. So surgical strategy should be based on preoperative imaging study and thorough understanding of normal structures and abnormal structures is very important one too. Prevent any type of neurovascular structure injury. And also, careful operation planning is very essential, and treatment should be patient-specific. I mean, even though the diagnosis is same, but surgery should be different in each type of the anatomical variation or anatomical morphology. Successful outcome is a product of sufficient evaluation, appropriate selection of the instrumentation and sound surgical technique. Thank you.